responsible for a portion of the state's overall unfunded liability, and, which means you're going to pay for it. And by the way, we're going to restrict you from having the ability of raising property taxes, and we're going to restrict you from raising employee contributions. So they didn't tell the municipalities how to solve the problem, but it became a shared approach to solving the problem by making other organizations responsible for a part of the debt. So it brought them to the table, they had to solve the problem, that liability became theirs. I don't know if that makes sense here.
Increasingly we do that in two ways, and I can speak from, let me speak as a manager of an employer in the PERS system. You know, we're assigned our piece, and the 15-ish percent of salary, whatever we're paying now, will go up to 30 or 35% on the chart you saw, and we know it pretty with, you know, high degree of certainty going up. Under GASB 68, that was just implemented for public entities, we now book it as a liability on our balance sheet, which is a big one. And we fundamentally at OHSU have about 4% of the liability, and it's my head, but I think it's in the ballpark. And 4% of a very large number is a very large number for us. I think you're absolutely right. I think that does focus the attention of it. And one thing we're thinking about is when we have one-time revenue, what do we put aside?
It certainly brings people to the table for them to come up with their own solutions at a much deeper, broader level than we're going to be able to by looking at 900 entities.
Well, the question I was asking earlier was kind of getting at this question. Don't they already own this liability?
Yeah, so it is apportioned out among the various employers. So I do look at what is the liability for the state of Oregon, what is our cost for the state of Oregon from our employee side perspective. And we have these conversations at my side from a CFO for the state. That's the piece that I focus on, and so that's the piece I worry about, just like OHSU is maybe looking at its share. When I do setting the rates for my sub-employers, if you will, all of my various agencies, I've got some that are getting police and fire rates. I've got to charge a higher employer rate for that group than I do the general staff that are out there. So I am managing it at the agency level for us, or the employer level.
Can I just point out, in your packet, there's a single page that lists the cumulative liability by entity type, right? So you'll see the state is $3.3 billion of the 21. You know, it doesn't have a page number on it. It's in the middle of all the fine print. It looks like this. So cities, counties, So you can see here that this is really important. It goes back to what Don was saying, which is we're really all in this together. The state only, even if you added the state and school districts together, it's only 40% of the total.
Yeah.
And then I think also in the fine print, Rick, I'll just say that on the fine print in the pages starting after that, you can see the individual liability by entity and as a percentage of their payroll. So you'll see that the city of Chiloquin really has no UAL, whereas the city of Beaverton has a UAL that's 192% of their payroll. So there's a real challenge also with, I think, ultimately, ability to pay. So I will just comment, Rick, having thought about that a little bit, I think there's a question about some being really creative and figuring out how they will meet their UAL, and some that are much further underwater.
Yeah.